Francesco, it's good to have you, and thank you very much for this conversation. We are all nervous going to next week to COP26. So tell me, what are your hopes and fears going to COP26? And where would you like the world to be on climate issue 10 years from now?
You know, that's everyone is asking, so what could be Glasgow to be considered a success? I'll say, Makhtar, that I consider that the COP26 has been already a success. In which sense? If you look at where we were 2 years ago and where we are now, with so many countries in all parts of the world committing to the net zero strategy, was something that was not thinkable just 2 years ago. In these days, also the Gulf region come with very important commitment for net zero strategy. So I think that the main result of the COP was to let the 1.5 Celsius window still open. I think that the commitments that came in this last period naturally are not enough, but we are much closer to our goals, and the window for the 1.5 pathway is still there. So in my point of view, this is already an achievement. And when you ask me where we should be in 2030, you know, we have launched our World Energy Transition Outlook. We say where we should be in 2030. And our roadmap is perfectly in line with what the IPCC says. So it means 45% less CO2 emission if we consider to 1990. And that's, we are there in our scenario. And we also see how the new energy system is building. It's building with clarity, but not with the speed and scale that we need. So direction travel is clear, but the speed and scale are not sufficient. But this is from my side. Now I want to know from your side, what are your hopes concerning the COP26? And what, how do you see the role of the private sector in this gathering and in the relationship with government? So you know that we are working with government. So I'm very interested to understand how the private sector is working and what could be done for working better.
Now, thank you very much for bouncing back my question and asking me the same. And you're perfectly right. If I want to think about what success looks like, is for me is far higher volume of private money being invested in climate adaptation and mitigation. I think, as you said, we have made significant progress in the last few years. All of the organization, development organization, IFC, the World Bank, and others, are revise a plan to be able to be aligned with our objective on emissions. We have a new climate change action plan, which is very ambitious, which will make us fully aligned to Paris 21 in 2025. And that will give us really an opportunity to mobilize more resources. To mobilize more resources, to have a higher level of mobilization, we need to come with new instruments. And I'm seeing a lot of innovation from our colleague working on treasury, on the capital market, which are using new type of bonds, which are using different instruments that allow them to mobilize more resources to finance adaptation and mitigation. Financing is going to area where we didn't see a lot of financing, like the blue economy. For instance, we are currently financing the first loan for blue economy in Indonesia. Is that making a lot of impact? But to do that, as you rightly said, we need to work with government. And what is the role of government? Is to have the right policies in place. It's important to set a clear low carbon and resilient direction for public sector. But I will emphasize one thing also, is to strengthen the capacity of the ministries of environment or other minister of energy to measure the impact of what we are doing on climate change. to be able to provide more data to the private sector, to provide more data to the public at large, so people are even more confident in investing in activities that will reduce emission. I think that there is still a very important gap in terms of measuring the CO2 emission, to measuring the impact of cooling on the atmosphere and other forms of activities which are related to climate change. You are the one talking to government all the time also. You have been able to really mobilize ministers and everybody to talk about these issues and at a very high level. So if I might ask you, what are the three key things that government can do to create the right condition for private sector, for any renewable energy to take off?
So I think we discussed this when we met last week in Washington, and again I thank you very much for your hospitality. So what we see, first of all, is the lack of the real planning and the ownership of this planning from the government, especially in the least developed country. And so what is important, first of all, and this what we are working with the government, is to have for all the region of IRENA. We have, for example, 5 regions in Africa. I mention Africa because I know that it's so close to your heart. So it's important that for all these regions, we can set the right planning in place. What I mean, you know, we have published the World Energy Transition Outlook that say and clarify what is the path the world as global should go for, be coherent with the 1.5 degrees pathway. But this will apply differently in the different region. So it's important that all regions may have a proper roadmap, a proper pathway to be coherent with 1.5, taking into account of the different circumstances, so that we can really know which are the priority in terms of investment concerning renewables, but also concerning the infrastructure that are needed for ensure and rapid deployment of renewables. And we are also planning, as we discussed it, to work on this domestic outlook, not only regional, but for the big countries, also trying to go into the details of their domestic outlook, so their pathway to the 1.5. This is so important, the planning. The other thing that you have already mentioned is important, that they may adjust the legal environment to provide more private money to come, more investment, private investment in the country. And on this, we are working with them in the context of the climate investment platform. That will have 2 streams of work. One related to projects and funding of a project. The other, putting together government and companies to understand what are the main, I'd say, changes in the legal environment for permitting more private investment. The other aspect is the stability. So the risking investment is possible where the stability is there. So it's very important that country work for ensuring an environment that will be open to the foreign investment, but also an environment that they will stay there for a sufficient length of time. So ensure security to the companies. So these are the area where we are working with the government. Naturally, we are working also in the area of projects, but I can come later to this if you want to investigate with me these aspects. So so we are talking about the same thing. So how to make money flowing into the country, I think, is where your organization is working more. So what do you see in respect of also what I have said for having more money flowing to the developing countries? And what are the challenges that you see?
Yes, you're perfectly right. I think that one of the things is, we talked about it many times, is a lack of bankable project. But we have said that, but now we need to deal with that. And I think that one of the problems often is that there is not a clear planning. That's what you just said is so powerful, that a government need to have a strategy on the long term and say, this is where I want to go in terms of my energy matrix. This is a composition of renewable. This is where I think that the private sector should be investing. This is what I'm expecting. Still, we have often non-solicited bid which are proposed to government, and it's not necessarily coming from a very structured strategy as countries have. So the more visibility government investors we have in terms of government strategy on the type of project, the more we will be able to attract the money. To do that, it's important, when I was talking about strengthening the capacity of the public sector, we will need to have PPP units in those major sectors, in particular is the Ministry of Finance, working with the Ministry of Energy, working with the Ministry of Transport, we keep working on ministries of infrastructure. We are dealing with all these issues of solid waste and other type of waste, and prepare a solid pipeline of projects that could be presented to the private sector and would could be invested over time. So that's a very important thing. That's a number one, and I think that if a conversation can be made in a COP26 to move on this agenda, practically that would be very helpful to put money in strengthening the capacity of government to prepare bankable project, to think long term and to have a strategy for that. The second one, which is a challenge that you and I we talked last time about, is the fast evolution of the technology. So we are at a time where you had a very fast adoption of new technologies. They were there in the past, but the pace of adoption, because of the desire of population and policymakers to reduce emission, is accelerated, talking about hydrogen, offshore, battery storage. All these are moving very fast. And we know that this cost will go down very quickly. And the question is to try to have as much predictability at the pace at which it will go down, so that it can be included in the design of contract. Because sometimes some countries are saying, for me good to be able to have a contract at this price when maybe I can anticipate in 2-3 years a fall in the price of that technology, and therefore how can it be reflected in the design of the contract that we sign with the private sector? So this is the second element. The third one is a created platform. Once we have a model, once we have a way of doing that, to really move very fast and have a quick model that could be replicated. And that's what we are calling the platforms. We did it in a solar energy, and it was very successful with that initiative of scaling solar that we implemented in Africa, in Central Asia, and that created a lot of impact. Now, we are also working, as I say, on the financial market, on the green bonds and the blue bonds, and all these bonds also necessitate some regulation that will need to be improved, and sometime we need to have what you call sandbox regulation to be able to adapt it until we have a more final regulation. We also need to help our client adopt the new technology and business model. And I think that one of the big challenges now is to push for lowering the cost of storage, because I think that's what will be allowing us to leapfrog and be able to adopt all these new technology which are being developed.
So that's good. And you answer, to say, respond also to demand, why we are partnership together. Because we share a lot of a common understanding of how the reality is and how we can impact on the reality. So this is the reason for us to working with government to have a list of bankable projects. And as you know, we have been already received more than 280 proposals for projects. We have already select 60 of them that may be promising. And for the half of them, we are already to show to you and the other financial entities that are part of our climate investment platform for funding. Waiting finally for having also the chance to meet in person in our investment forum. So all, as you say, is showing that working together has been a very good move from our side, and we are looking forward, Makhtar, to collaborate closely with you in all ways and means to accelerate the deployment of renewables to finally fight the climate change, but also provide energy for the people of your continent. Well, still we have 100 million people without the basic service, without clean cooking. So I think that all these elements are what are at stake, and we have to work in partnership to find a way to facilitate the way out for our customers, for our citizens.
Now, thank you so very much. And I would like to wish you a happy birthday, because IRENA is 10 years old now. He's a relative young, but has done so many things in during the 10 years. You took IRENA in different phases, and I would like really to congratulate you for the leadership and impulse you are giving to IRENA, and the way you are really expanding the partnership with institutions like IFC, but others, and you can count really definitely on us to be your strong partner in working in developing renewable energy in the world. So I look forward to seeing you in Glasgow, and thank you really very much for your support and for your very, very nice collaboration.
Thank you, Makhtar, and see you in Glasgow.